What is up and what is good, YouTube? I'm SoCal Shaolin. I'm back in Los Angeles for another Killer Clowns from Outer Space event. Tonight's event is going to be held right there at the Los Feliz Theater. It's going to be a midnight movie showing. This theater has been around since the 30s, so it's pretty old. It's going to be pretty cool to watch this movie over here. It's always cool to watch this movie in the big screen. It's being hosted by John Massari, the composer of the film, and the Kyoto Brothers, creators and directors of the movie. Looking forward to watching this one again, never get tired of it. I want to thank John Massari for the invite. Always fun to come up from San Diego to these events. And it is sold out, so if you saw my last video with the live orchestra from the summer, it was awesome. It was an event not to miss, and today shouldn't be any different.
Hey, SoCal Shaolin, you totally rock. Thank you for coming out all the way from San Diego. Is it from San Diego?
Or yes,
from
San Diego.
Oh, wow. Cool. Thank you for being here. Thank you for checking all this out. We're going to have a lot of stuff going on. We've got Steve Kiano, the director, right here.
It'll be great. Fantastic.
We've got a really great show. We're up here in Hollywood. High to San Diego. You got to come up here. I know San Diegans don't have much love for LA, but you know what? I love San Diego. Hopefully you will love LA.
Make sure you follow him on Instagram.
Yes.
John Massari.
Yeah.
Check out all the cool stuff he has. Get yourself a soundtrack.
Showing scary horror and wacky movies, I guess, you know. And before, I'm not going to waste any of your time. This is Chris.
Hello.
And Bernie's up there somewhere. And you can visit us on Facebook. Let us know what movies you'd like to see. Right. Ladies and gentlemen, the composer of Killer Clowns from Outer Space, John Mazzeri. And of course, ladies and gentlemen, the Kyoto Bros. Hey there! So, we're just gonna let them talk to you guys, talk about Killer Clowns, 30th anniversary! Killer Clowns from Outer Space, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah.
I think we're all from New York.
It's undelighting here. I'm pretty
spooky. Hey, thanks everybody for coming out.
Say hello. If y'all can say hello to England.
Hey, England.
And Manchester, specifically. Well, thank you all for coming, and thank you, brothers, for coming here too. And this is like the most dumbest question in the world, but is there anyone who has not seen this movie? Please stand up. No point.
And is that people?
We want to.
How many of you have seen it?
Hey, brave lady.
How many of you have seen it in the theater?
How many people have never seen it in the theater? Whoa! You are in for a surprise.
Because this is the way you're supposed to see it. When you're with people, it's just funnier when it's more people.
Yes.
It doesn't make the movie better, it just makes it bigger.
Here's another question. Who has seen this movie in May with the live orchestra and the Dickies performing? Stand up! Stand up, my dear man. You guys, awesome. That is awesome. Now, here's a, should we ask if anyone's been to?
No.
I tell you what, we're here not to tell you things, but to answer questions. I know you guys don't have the opportunity to really talk to all of us here, so if you have any questions about the film, later on I think John's going to show you some clips of that concert that he produced. For those who hadn't seen it live, we have some behind-the-scenes clips of that, which is an upcoming documentary that he's producing right now. So questions from you guys, anything you want to know about clowns?
We didn't.
Our music supervisor just was friends with their manager and thought it would be a cool thing to do. He pitched them the title, told them a little bit about the movie, and then Leonard came back with the song and played it for us, and we said, this is like perfect.
It was.
We had no other input besides the title, so when we actually heard it for the first time, we were very pleased. And what it did was, it brought a whole new audience to the film. I mean, we knew we had the horror genre fans, but it brought along this punk contingency, the people that followed the Dickies. So it was really a diverse group of fans.
You know what?
I'm glad we liked it. I don't know what we would have done if we thought it sucked.
Absolutely. And, you know, Leonard, he had not seen the movie until it was absolutely... So it was fully finished.
Yeah, exactly. You know, what we're gonna tell you, we don't like Jacaranda, you know, it was like perfect.
Great.
You just nailed it.
Well, it's magical things that just happen.
So who here has tattoos? Killer Clown tattoos specifically.
I saw one.
One hand went up. I know there's more.
Show it.
So I'm sure the scuttlebutt is all the different Killer Clowns projects in the future. Do you guys have any information on any future Killer Clowns project? The return of the Killer Clowns, or the television show?
Cartoon!
And all the kind of, we're hoping for all of the above.
Well,
you know, we've been working on a sequel since we made the film, so for 30 years we've been pitching and developing something, but Hollywood can be really difficult, and it's hard to get a film financed nowadays on what is really a cult film. It doesn't really have the box office that gives a lot of the bean counters the confidence it's going to do well. So you guys coming out like this and spreading the word about clowns is really important. The past success of It, the most recent success, it made so much money that I think it's kind of made some of the people at MGM aware that this is a valuable property. So I can just tell you this, more than ever, we're closer. There's rumblings about something happening. And it could be a streaming, it could be a film, it could be a cartoon, it could be a lot of different things. We're really excited about it. Oh, and VR. Can you believe it? Talking about a VR experience.
Also, we got a really big boost from Universal Orlando.
The horror haunt that they did was received very, very well, which only builds the franchise and the IP of clowns, gives it more value. In the past, I used to say, don't hold your breath for the sequel. Now I'll tell you guys, hold your breath. keep watching the skies, I guess.
Throw them out. What do you got?
What about a sing-along?
Any more immersive events like this one? I know they had a whole It House tour, like the movie launch and the back. Just for the 30th anniversary, you're going to be doing more things.
As far as the anniversary, this might be kind of the last hurrah for the 30th, but then we could celebrate the 31st year.
I have orchestra booking organization that has packaged the show that we did in May, and we might have something sooner than you think happening in that room. In as far as live to film with the orchestra, with the film playing and the Dickies playing, And it comes as a package, so it's like a show that will kind of tour.
Yeah. But
I don't have any specific dates yet.
In terms of like other things, I mean the Scare Zone at the Horror Nights in Florida, Orlando, was just a huge success. Fans just really loved it. There was an incredible outpouring of love for the movie. So you know, we're hopeful that maybe that gets built up into a house next year and maybe goes bi-coastal.
Yeah, that would be great.
We all visited that Scare Zone, and we noticed that most people walk through Scare Zones, but the Killer Clown Scare Zone, everyone hung out and partied. They got their food, because the music score was playing, and the Dickie song was playing constantly, and everyone was just dancing. It was just
It was really, really immersive. I mean, that's like the closest I think people could get it to like the clown universe, walking among the clowns, and you know, the projections on the buildings, the clown tent, the clips of the movie, the soundtrack just playing, just great ambiance.
You know, there have been a few people have done projects with clowns. You've seen clown movies, and you know, a lot of people have made movies where clowns kill people. We make Killer Clowns from Outer Space in a way that no one's ever done before. We see clowns a little different than everybody, and I'm glad you appreciate it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anything? We have a trilogy in four parts that we plan, and an arc following the three characters, and introducing it to a new audience, a new generation. It's a what we call a requel.
Because don't you all want to go to the clown planet?
Yes.
I do.
Well, I imagine we would. We would introduce a new protagonist, new young people who are experience the clowns for the first time, but then on their journey, during their experience, we meet Mike Tobacco, who's really just a drunk living in a van down by the river. And then in the third part of the trilogy in four parts, we would meet Debbie Stone again and see what happened to her. And then the last part would be Dave the Cop. He got into politics and now he's running for president and he knows the truth about clowns. And that might be the story that takes us to the ultimate clown planet. What planet do you think they come from?
No, it's unpronounceable.
Right. That's a good question. Any ideas? Where are they? I mean, what planet has a big red nose? With a spot? Jupiter, of course.
Deep inside.
And we get into ancient astronauts and the clowns were here before the dawn of time, cave paintings that actually have remnants of clowns. Those cavemen actually drew them on the cave walls. It's incredible. It's vast and epic. So just keep on talking about clowns and let MGM know that you're interested,
yes,
that it is a viable franchise to exploit. And once they know that, they'll exploit the hell out of it.
Can you guys tell some stories about the development and the production of the film?
Talk about how we pitched it, our first pitch.
Yeah, it was
a classic story.
Yeah, a friend of ours, producer Fred Fuchs, who's working with, we were working with him on Shelley Duvall's Fairy Tale Theater. And he said he had some friends who had just come into a production fund if we had any ideas. So we went in with a 20-page treatment. Stephen had done a little sculpture, a little maquette of a clown holding a puppet ray gun, and Charlie had done a one-sheet poster of a clown overlooking a sleepy little town. And we went in there and we pitched it to Moshe Diamant and Paul Mason of Transworld Entertainment. And at the end of the pitch, Moshe, I like this. I want to make this movie. We sold it in the room. Our very, very first motion picture pitch ever.
And I think he bought it for the title.
I think he said, I could sell that. I could sell that.
Very classic Hollywood producer.
And they had no idea what we were going to do. I think they thought we were going to have a bunch of humans in makeup with chainsaws killing people.
Hey, this is easy.
we're on our way. So, you know, then we made the movie. Then we found out the only thing harder than making your first movie is
trying to make
your second movie.
And the difficulty of production is when the executive producers, or we were the executive producers, when the company behind you financing it isn't on the same page. They wanted something much simpler. They didn't realize what we had gotten them into. We were building, you know, 100 cotton candy cocoons. We were renting a warehouse to make this giant clown fun house and stuff. And they were saying, they were trying to figure out ways that, well, you know, let's break, you know, you guys are working too hard. And the crew wanted to go, they wanted to work with us. They wanted to work 24 hours a day. So basically the production company was working with us, the art departments, all the creative people were working with us. It was the execs from Transworld that were trying to slow us down and shut us down and mess us up in different ways. It's a really an uphill battle to get a film off the ground. We're lucky it came out as good as it did.
But it was funny, they were making another movie at the same time in Sri Lanka, and it was a nightmare, it was a disaster. So all our bosses, all the executives, went to India, and they were on that movie, and they left us alone in Santa Cruz. And the people that they sent us to like babysit us, the crew didn't like them, but they really liked us. So we kind of rallied them on our side to get kind of make the movie that we wanted to. I mean, in terms of like nightmares, if you ever listen to the audio commentary on the DVD, I think it's on the current Blu-ray, it's kind of like a primer on how horrible a low-budget production can be.
Yeah, it's really a bitch fest, really.
Yeah, I mean, we had a first AD who was, he was an older guy, and he was just, we shot 6 weeks all at night. Even when we went, the first plan was 3 weeks going to be out at night, because the movie takes place all at night. But then we're moving on to stage, everyone's looking forward to going to the stage where we finally be able to switch to the days. Well, the first day we went to the set, the art department had been working all night trying to get the sets ready, but it was so freaking cold in Santa Cruz, the paint was wet. It was literally wet paint. We were waiting for the sets to dry. So, well, it was a massive warehouse. We couldn't afford to heat it, so we decided to keep the company on at night. The art department worked during the day, and we'd be shooting at night indoors. And the Transworld people just freaked, saying, "You can't do that, you know, who do you think you're in charge of?" Saying, "Well, we're in charge."
Yeah. who do you think you are? We said, "We're the producers."
They were fighting us all the time. You remember, they used to make film with something called film. Yeah, and you know, there's a thing called video assist that they use now. We didn't have video assist. We had to rely on our DP and his assistant to look at it. So Steven would say, "All right, this is what I want. I want the clowns to come in this way. I want this, and I want them to exit this way." And you know, Steven would yell "roll," and then he would yell "cut," and he'd ask the DP, "Did you get it?" "Yeah, we got it." We have to wait 2 days for the dailies to come back, and we saw that he didn't get it.
And I guess another kind of funny story. The during the clowns coming out of the car, we built that in a loading dock. We covered the loading dock so we had dead space underneath so the clowns could come up through the car. And we'd been setting it up all night, and we were behind schedule. And the sun was rising. Not that it mattered. We were fucking inside, you know. So, but the first AD was just—he was calling it. He was said, "Ed, we're not going to get this. We're going to have to pull a plug. I'm going to pull a plug on you." And I said, "No, we've been setting it up all night. That was the hard part. Shooting is going to take 20 minutes to do it. Let's do it." And he and I got into an argument. And so the producer, me, and the first AD get into an argument, and it was getting in my face, and then the director has to step in and break us up.
I have to break up a fight with the AD and the producer. And the crew was on our side.
I mean, the crew didn't mind. They said, no, we'll wait, you know, we'll shoot this thing. And the AD, and the second AD, they were arguing with everybody. They wanted to go home. Not the best atmosphere to make a film.
Well, I had something similar. You came to my house to hear whatever music I was working on, and I had the what was his name, FEMA, the post-production supervisor, calls me and says, "By the way, you have to pay the Dolby sound licensing bill." I go, "What?" "Yeah, because since we're exhibiting it in Dolby surround sound, you know that should be your expense." And I said, "Well, you know, is the cinematographer paying for the processing of the film?" "No." She said, "Well, I shouldn't be doing that." So Steven comes and he hears this. Then he gets on the phone with the guy above this guy and screams for like a half an hour. It was wonderful. I wish I could have. I would have put it on Instagram and we had it at the time. But it was classic. And I was laughing the whole time.
Actually, we couldn't afford Dolby. We didn't get Dolby surround. It was ultrasound.
Doubly.
Remember, it was ultrasound.
Ultrasound?
Yeah.
That's why it sounds.
That was the competing surround sound
system.
It's
not just sound, it's ultrasound.
No, we had a DP who came from television, and Stephen wanted to sit down and say, well, this is the kind of mood that I want. I want a three quarters backlit. I want a very mysterious lighting. He stopped Stephen and said, don't worry, Steve. I'll get you an exposure. And that's why the lighting on the film isn't what as dramatic as it possibly could be, because we had a DP who came from television and was just trying to get the film exposed.
I guess it started with me. I was trying to imagine the most frightening image I could think of. And for me, it was driving down a lonely mountain road, and all of a sudden I see headlights behind me, and as a car passes, I look over and it's a clown. And a clown being where he shouldn't be is really frightening. I mean, obviously, they're up to no good. And then from there it went to, well, maybe what if he wasn't in a car, what if it was just floating? Well, then he's from outer space, and then, well, he's here to kill people, so.
What else?
But it was, I mean, killer clowns from outer space kind of set it all.
And eat people.
So that was it, very simple. I mean, and actually it was I think we struck a nerve in everybody. I mean, I don't think people, well, some people do embrace clowns, but I think there's a little nervousness you have about clowns, especially when you're really young. We made our clowns really, really tall to kind of recreate what it's like when you're a child and you have a clown. It's like they get in your personal space and they kind of fuck around with you, you know? You know, I'm not frightened about them, I just don't care for them.
The thing is, you know, we had seen, you know, scary clown movies, not a lot, but we saw scary clown movies, and, you know, they were always maniacs with knives, you know, serial killing, you know, clowns that did stuff. So we had this, you know, Stephen had the idea, well, you know, clown is the scariest thing. Well, the Kyoto Bros, we never do things the way other people do it. We decided, you know, let's put a spin on it. We made them from outer space, and they kill them in ways that are fun and exciting and imaginative. We call them cotton candy kill.
Thank you, everybody. Enjoy.
All right, YouTube, it's bright and early the next morning in Los Angeles. That Killer Clowns event went all the way to like 3 a.m., but it's always a good time watching that movie on the big screen with an audience. And for those of you that missed the event or couldn't make it, I hope you guys enjoyed the Q&A with John Massari and the Kyoto Brothers. Make sure you follow John Massari on Instagram and on YouTube at John Massari. Look for him. Keep up with what's going on with him and all things Killer Clown related. But guys, thanks again for watching the video. If you liked it, hit the like button. If you have any comments, leave them below. Let me know what your favorite Killer Clowns from Outer Space memories are. What's your favorite things of the movie? What do you like best? If you guys want to see the video from the live orchestra event that was held over the summer, I'll leave a link down below. Check that out. It has over 300,000 views. It was an awesome event. Hopefully they could get that going like a tour. That's what John Massari is working on right now. Hopefully that comes true, man, and comes to your city. You can check it out with the live orchestra. It was awesome. Thanks again for watching, YouTube. I'm SoCal Shaolin. Catch you guys next time. I'm out.